Hey everyone, Patrick here. Today I would like to talk to you about parameterizing a sales query using Ibis. So for those of you that don't know me, my name is Patrick. I am a product manager of Ultron Data, and my background is in data pipelining. This is analytics, data engineering, automation, streamlining, basically anything that touches data, I've probably done it before. I've been doing this for about 9-10 years, and most of my work has been in the advertising sector. So a lot of what I do is take parameters given by an analyst or a consultant or a measurement team or someone that cares about some kind of data, and then take those parameters and stuff them into queries and generate queries for them to use. Sometimes these queries run in a script, like in the cloud somewhere, and then they output some like Excel file or maybe a pandas data frame somewhere that someone can manipulate or comb through or send to someone else without looking at it. But regardless, like the idea is I am taking inputs and procedurally generating these queries. Typically I use fStrings. So I'm also relatively new to Ibis. I've been using it for less than, I think, 4 months now. And to familiarize myself with the package, I decided to rebuild something called, something that I call a sales data query. So this takes sales data from a typical star schema and then manipulates it into a data frame or some kind of tabular data that an analyst or a consultant can use to either export to Excel or maybe just comb through in a pandas data frame or just feed into a calculator so that they can get some metric that they care about. So what I did is I started by creating a mock data set. I used a notebook that's provided inside of this repository. So all of my code is inside this repo. You can find it at my username, which is Patrick. And then the repo is Ibis sales query. The first step is I created a mock data set using this notebook. This simulates some sales data and adds some noise that one might typically find in sales data, so like closed stores, new stores, spikes in sales. And then after I created that data set, I uploaded it to a SQLite DB file, and this file will sit inside the local directory. And then I could use that database file to build my queries and execute them. So first, I built the sales data query from scratch using fStrings, and then I built the sales data query from scratch using Ibis expressions. If you are curious about a lot of the things that I have to say inside these notebooks, so I included some notes and I do a side-by-side comparison of the methods inside these notebooks. If you're curious about what I have to say, you can just download it. It's free. Just go to GitHub, download it, or you can use Binder, which is what I'm doing to preview these notebooks in this talk. Okay, so available inside this notebook or this repo is the mock sales data notebook. You could run this and get the data, and it'll create a DB file. You can update the parameters to make the data as big or as small as you want. It just creates sales data and puts them into a star schema. After you have that set up, you can then walk through each of these side by side sales data notebooks. On the left here, I have the fString notebook, and on the right here, I have the Ibis notebook. So I'll go through each one just a little bit, just a brief review. I'm not going to go through all these awesome words that I wrote, just to outline some of the differences. So first, I start off with some typical configuration parameters. Usually, it's some kind of identifier for how the measurement is set up. So an analyst ID could be like a store segmentation. It could contain all the following parameters, but for now, let's just assume that all the objects are independent of some configuration somewhere in the cloud. Product groups, typically like a set of sets. So these are group names with the definition for those groups. So here I have product 0, product 4 inside of group 1. And what I'll do with these groups is I will pivot my data along these groups of products. So instead of giving a long fact sale part, what I'll do is I will aggregate using a case when statement. So case when product name in here, then sum of group one, or sum of them, their value as group one. And then I'll do that for all the groups. And then I'll add some miscellaneous groups like included, excluded products. So I won't filter our product set. And then I also have some test periods and control periods. These are basically just time series along our data for abstract date periods or time periods. So that could be days, could be hours, but in this case, it's weeks. Typically, sales data is weekly by store. Then I point to our database. So this is salesdata.db. This should be in the local directory after we run the mock data set notebook. Then we explore our data set using select count star. Here on the left, we're using a formatted string. So we just feed in a table name as a string, and then we get a query string back, and then we run the IPython notebook classic read SQL, which is a function that just takes a SQL string and dumps it into pandas read SQL with a connector, and then we get our count back. On the right here, we have a table expression of whatever table we pick. So here I have a dictionary of tables, table expressions. I can just call them one by one and then run the count method on them, which will give me a count of rows, which will give me the exact same results. So on the right here, one call out is it's a little bit more Pythonic. So a Python user, pandas user, PySpark user, someone that's unfamiliar with SQL might find this a little bit easier to read, a little bit easier to understand. Whereas this, you actually have to, realize what's going on inside of your fstring. Same deal on the left here. I am selecting just the count of rows per partition. So there's a date, store, product, unit partition that I care about, and I want to check to see how many rows are in the data for each instance of that part. And here I'm just doing it where the count is greater than one, and I'm seeing that there are duplicate rows along that partition. I do the same thing here using the size method on just a table expression. Again, this is all Python, no fstrings, no multi-line strings. And then I get the same thing. I'm going to skip the filtering one, but basically, same deal. On the left here, you're using an fstring, and then you're basically like feeding a looped when statement into, or when predicates into a when statement, or where clause, rather. So select star from fact sale, join, join, join. And then you have where, new line, and then an and linking your where predicates. So this is the loop of predicates, but here we are generating our predicates using basically just a loop and Python expressions, which is, again, a lot easier to read for someone familiar with Python, less familiar with SQL. Similarly, we wanted to filter on a set of things. So suppose we have an iterable, so a control period, start period, end period. Then we can, in the fstring solution, feed in our periods directly into a between clause, between predicate. So here I'm taking two periods and then just finding the union of the two. And I'm using a formatted, whatever, expanding the list as arguments in the format method. And then on the right here, we have, instead of doing that, we could just feed in the objects directly to a method called between. So we take our column expression, which is dim date, date value, and then whatever is between this period, or using this for symbol, dim date, date value between the test period. Again, very Pythonic. It's a lot easier to read if you're not familiar with SQL, more familiar with programming languages. Now, the reason why I'm stressing that is because it gets a lot more complicated when you are using types that don't actually fit in strings correctly. So, with lists of integers, you have to actually format that to a string somehow. So, what I do here is I take my list of integers to filter dim store, and then I feed them into the join method on a comma string. So, I'm making a comma delimited list of integers and then making that a string. And then I feed that string into another string, and then I return a string. On the right here, I actually just take that iterable, which is a list of integers, and then I feed it into the isIn method. I don't convert it, I just use it as is. Now, the reason this is important is because I take these two queries, and then I feed them into a larger query. So on the left here, I have a fact sale query, which takes in all my dimension tables that are filtered, including the dim date and dim store filters that I showed earlier, and then feed them into a much larger query, which I get this on the left. See here, like all my conditions, some of my predicates are hidden or like buried, like well within the queries, the subqueries of the main query. And I won't know if there's anything wrong with this until my code actually runs. Like I try to execute against the back end. So I take my SQL, I generate it. Syntactically, my Python is fine. But once I get to query execution, it barfs for some reason. And then if you saw my last video, I might get an ambiguous error, in which case I don't know what's going on, and I'll have to read through all my code to make sure I don't have a typo somewhere. Or I'll use resources in a pipeline, and then I'll get to this query, it'll barf, and then wow, I just wasted a whole bunch of resources. And okay, so I have to iterate on my query and get it right. On the right here, I have my Ibis expressions. So I basically take those definitions that I created earlier, and then basically do my Python expressions, my Ibis expressions to join the tables together, and I get my filter. Again, this whole time, I'm not converting anything to fStrings. I'm not converting one Python object to another. I'm just using the objects as is. I can then pivot with case when, or sum over case when. So on the left here, I have a sum case when product name in sum set, then value else zero end as product name. And what I could do is basically just I establish this skeleton right here, and then loop through my product groups and format my query, my case when statement to fit my product groups in them. I can then append them to a list and then feed that list into a list of aggregate statements. I do the same thing with the undefined groups, so the included, excluded. If you want to read more about this, you can go to the repo and just read the doc strings or the markdowns. I compile all these statements together, and then I get my final query, which is my sales data query. And that final query is on the left here. It's just this really long string. And it has the same problems that I mentioned earlier. If there's a problem with it, syntactically, my Python might be fine. I'm generating a string. Strings are very hard to mess up. So SQL string, easy, fine. But upon execution, it barfs, and like I don't know what went wrong. So I'd have to come through it and iterate on the query until I get it right. Whereas with Ibis, it checks metadata on the tables that you're using. So once you establish a table expression, there's metadata there, and it checks types and references on operations you're doing so that if there's a problem, it will fail in line before execution. So here I do my case when statements. Again, I'm just using Python expressions. So I use an isIn, ifElse, establishes a case when. So value zero, and then sum as an aggregate expression for all my product groups. And then I do the exact same thing for my undefined groups. I compile them together to create my case when statements. And then I compile everything together under a nice little top to bottom logical flow of get your fact sale query, pick your group by columns, construct your case when statements, and then construct your final query and then return it. I run that and I get the exact same result. So 66,000 rows, 66,000 rows, head is the same. The columns are out of order because I did the fstring one before and I wanted to include analysis ID, but I forgot to add that in the fstring solution. Anyways, if you want to know more about this, if you want the source code and use it in your own workflows or in your own projects, you can go to github.com, Patrick, Ibis Sales Query, and yeah, download it, try it on Binder, click this, and you're good. Thanks.